Tonight. It's really a pleasure for me and an honor to have here one of the best American writers of our days, Michael Cunningham. For more than a year, I tried to find a way to invite him at the Institute, but for one reason or another, I failed. Some of you know that last February, we started a series of conversation and lectures with American writers about Italy. The first was Jun Palahiri, who spoke about Italian language, since her last book is written in Italian. Then we had Andrea Assiman, David Levitt, Salman Rushdie, who spoke about Umberto Eco, together with Siri Usved, Dalia Sofer, who told her relationship with Giorgio Banzani, and so on. I met Michael Cunningham in Italy, in Florence, when he was for Gregon Forestieri Award, a beautiful initiative organized with passion and love by Beatrice Monti della Torre, who is here tonight with us. And I read Beautiful the Hours, which won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction and the Pen Faulkner Award. This is the reason I would like to have him at the Institute. Michael Cunningham is a novelist and a screenwriter. Among his books, I would like to remember Home at the End of the World and At Nightfall. I said at the beginning that for a long time I failed in trying to have Cunningham in our series. If eventually he is here tonight, also it's the weather it's against us, I have to thank him for his kindness and his will to find a way to accept our invitation. And APT Basilicata, which asked Michael Cunningham to go to Matera and write a piece about this incredible city. None of APT Basilicata is here tonight, but they asked us to screen a short film about Matera shot by a young English filmmaker, and I ask to let it start. We'll be right back. Okay, thank you. And now, Michael Cunningham.
Buonasera. Thank you all for being here in this weather. thank you for having me. A particular thank you to my friend Beatrice von Rezzori, who has introduced me to Italy and has read more books than anyone I've ever met. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
A little more. Oh yeah. Cordless mic is more fun anyway, right? A little more Las Vegas. I would, with your kind permission, love to read you a short piece I wrote about Matera when I went there last year. In Japan, Shinto Buddhists destroy their shrines every 20 years and then rebuild them exactly as they were to remind themselves that everything is transitory, but then again, everything returns. In Barcelona, construction continues on the Sagrada Familia Church, which was left unfinished when its architect, Antoni Gaudí, was killed in 1926. The work is impeded, however, by the fact that Gaudí's plans for the church were destroyed in a fire by inept abstract sculptures added to the Western facade in the 60s and 70s, and by an ongoing shortage of funds. The two fountains of mercury meant by Gaudí to flank the main facade are not likely to be built, at least not anytime soon. The perennially unfinished Sagrada Familia reminds us that the churches we imagine may always be grander than any completed church can ever be, which is probably integral to their sacredness. We venerate not only the church itself, but the idea of a more fabulous church, which the existing church merely symbolizes. In the city of Matera, in the Basilicata region of southern Italy, an annual parade held in honor of the Madonna della Bruna, the city's patron saint, features an elaborate, exquisitely constructed float that once it's rolled through the streets and reached the central square, is demolished by citizens who literally tear it to pieces until there's nothing left. This serves to remind the people of Matera that every human creation, from churches to parade floats, could always be better than it is. Each year, an even more splendid float is built, and each year, it's torn apart again, because perfection will always elude human efforts, no matter how skilled, no matter how inspired. Matera knows about perseverance. It knows about the urge to complete that which can never be completed. Matera is one of the oldest, it may actually be the oldest continually inhabited cities in the world. Although its exact age is impossible to determine, it certainly dates back to the Paleolithic era, when human beings first started making tools out of stone. Matera was a fully established, thriving city by the arrival of the Bronze Age. The city has been carved over eons into an outcropping of limestone that rises above the surrounding farmland like a giant fist bursting up from deep within the earth. Many of Matera's habitations are caves, and many of its buildings, or what appear to be buildings, are facades, the interiors of which prove to be caves as well. Matera is like a giant beehive, solid looking on the outside, but actually made up almost entirely of tunnels, passageways, chambers, and chambers atop chambers. If most cities aspire to the erection of ever taller buildings, which speak of our attempts to reach the sky, Matera speaks of a more primal urge to burrow into the earth, to be held and protected there. Matera, its stones, its streets, its structures, is essentially all one color, a dusky unwhite, like a bone picked clean and left out in the desert for sun and rain to do their work. There are no trees, there's no grass. It seems that everything fragile, everything tractable, was blown away eons ago. Matera is made solely of that which can resist catastrophic force. Matera is what's left after the hurricanes. Now, when I went to Matera, I understood that you have to go there to truly comprehend the place. Pictures are fine, but they don't convey the feeling, which is palpable the moment you enter Matera, that you are a rather fragile being skating across the rock-hard surface of mortality itself. You are temporary. Matera is not. The narrow lanes of the Stasi, the oldest areas, are the most tangibly haunted, but they're haunted by spirits so long departed as to have shed their human particulars. Matera is haunted not by ghosts, but by humanness itself. Humanness scoured by time. Humanness in its purest and most essential form, divested of its habits, its battles, its yearnings, and its fears. Its ghosts are what would be left of us if everything we thought of as ourselves were stripped away. As you walk through Matera, you may glimpse its phantoms, but only fleetingly. That ancient human essence, that swirl of unquiet drifting across an otherwise silent piazza. Sorry, you missed it. No, but wait, there it is again, slipping past the doors of a church. No, it's gone again. Maybe you only imagined it. Matera is a place that inspires visions, just as it inspires doubts about one's visions. None of that shows up in photographs. Nor does the sight across the valley that divides the living city from the extinct one of the no longer inhabited caves, homes to troglodytes of the Paleolithic era, who you might imagine are looking back across the valley at you from the far side of the time-space continuum, each of you wondering over the dream you seem to be having about the other. Also unphotographable is the strange sepulchral cleanliness of the place, a spare and merciless Buddhist cleanliness that would be familiar to the Shintos who destroy and rebuild their shrines every 20 years. As well as the fact that in the evenings, the deepening sky fills with birds, which look from a distance to be swifts or thrushes, but prove, if you get closer, to be miniature falcons, replete with the falcon's predatory head and its unflinching, commonly murderous eyes. The falcons embody the harsh imperishability of Matera, a city that, in a certain sense, preys on time itself. Time, after all, eats almost everything. But it can't seem to eat Matera. And if Matera doesn't exactly eat time, it is as unconcerned about time as a falcon is about the sky. Now, I need to tell you a little more about Matera's history, because Matera is history, in ongoing collision with the present. It could be said that Matera is a living illustration of the fact that our histories create our present creates our future, and that's been going on nanosecond by nanosecond since the Earth was formed. Like most cities, even those a millennium or more younger, Matera has had its rises and its falls. It was for more than 200 years the capital of Basilicata. It has been visited by emperors and archbishops. There have been harder times too. As recently as the 1950s, conditions there were so bad, the majority of citizens living in caves without electricity or plumbing, that the government built new towns for them, conventional houses on grassy knolls, replete with power and water, but the people of Matera were unwilling to move. They preferred the discomforts of home, as people throughout history have tended to. We seem to favor the familiar over the strange, even if the strange is technically an improvement. Given the difficulty of life in Matera, it's not surprising that it tends to the worshipful. It's home to over 150 churches, many of them, yes, in caves, and many are covered in frescoes painted by anonymous painters 500 years or more before Giotto was born. Matera's religiosity took a more modern turn when Pier Paolo Pasolini filmed The Gospel According to St. Matthew there in 1963. At least a dozen films about the life of Christ have been filmed there since, because the Matera of today looks more like Christ's Jerusalem than Jerusalem itself. Now, among the most recent was Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ in 2004. A number of Materans still tell stories about their work as extras in the film, including a man who proudly proclaimed to me that his finger, pointing defiantly, but only his finger, is visible in one of the shots. Another Matera man showed me one of his prized possessions, a piece of the cross on which the actor playing Christ in the Passion of the Christ was crucified. I duly admired it. From politeness, I refrained from mentioning that it was a bit of wood from a Hollywood prop and not a fragment of the true cross. But it wasn't entirely clear that the difference mattered all that much to the owner of the 15-year-old wooden scrap. Which made sense in a place that existed thousands of years before the birth of Christ. I don't mean to be blasphemous, nor, I'm sure, do the people of Matera, when I say that Matera has been so often visited by emperors and holy men that both Pasolini and Gibson tend to seem like more recent members of an endless array of famous and illustrative people. Not by any means the most exalted, but not insignificant either. Now, Matera's fortunes have been steadily on the rise of late, not only since Mel Gibson made his movie there, but after the city was declared a World Heritage Site by UNESCO in 1993, and all the more so since it was designated a European Cultural Capital of Culture for 2019. In anticipation of the increased tourist hordes that are sure to arrive in 2019, there are now 5-star hotels in Matera and world-class restaurants, many of them in impeccably whitewashed and beautifully outfitted caves. There remains, however, a powerful sense that whether the grand hotels and fancy restaurants remain or not, Matera is not really subject to change, not in any deep or lasting way. It seems clear if you go there and walk its narrow streets that Matera will survive whatever ephemera the wind blows away, whether it's poverty or expensive hotels. Now, in closing, I should tell you a little more about those parade floats, the ones that are torn apart every July during the festival of the Madonna della Bruna. The tradition dates back to the 14th century, when Matera was ruled by a particularly corrupt count who lived so extravagantly that he doubled and then tripled taxes simply to pay his personal expenses. The Count's final intolerable act was to order a shoddy, threadbare float for the Festival of the Madonna, a cost-cutting gesture by a man who built golden palaces for himself and gambled away in a single night more than anyone in Matera earned in a year. The pitiful float, once it appeared in Matera's streets, was torn apart by citizens who had purely and simply had enough. The Count was subsequently attacked and killed as he left church by people who were never caught, though one of them, just before the murder, carved an unsigned confession into a column in the church, which is there to this day. Matera has been destroying the festival floats ever since, no matter how grand, no matter how beautiful. Now, if you go to the festival and see the float under attack, you may notice that the people who jump up and tear it apart, who take bits of it home, a papier-mâché cherub's wing, the base of a papier-mâché column, are almost always young. If you speak to them as they carry their treasures away, you may find that only a few have any idea about reenacting a rebellion against a greedy count who's been dead for more than 500 years. And yet the rite is performed faithfully every year, and it doesn't seem to make a great deal of difference if the men who reenact it know about the significance of the gesture or are just giddy with the annual permission to tear something apart. Who doesn't understand that impulse? It's Matera, after all. It's a city that contains countless stories and has been home to countless generations, some of which are remembered and some forgotten, and some of which are recorded in archives but unknown to most of the people who live there today. It's Matera, where a piece of a cross made by Hollywood to crucify an actor can be venerated simply because it's part of ongoing history, whether by history we mean the lives of the saints or the making of a movie. It's not as if stories and generations don't matter, but Matera is, first and foremost, a demonstration of survival itself, of the human ability to persist, even at great cost, and of our impulse to live where our forebears lived. Even if the place is harsh and uncomfortable, even if its soil is unyielding and its water supply negligible, still, it belongs to us, and we to it. You know, we are, if nothing else, a determined species. We all have survived so much. Until further notice, Shinto worshipers will destroy and rebuild their shrines every 20 years. The Sagrada Familia in Barcelona may one day be completed, but whether it's eventually finished or not, Gaudí's vision of it will always matter more than the church itself. Matera, still very much alive, gaunt and barren and strangely beautiful, has stood for millennia and may stand for millennia to come. For millennia, it has been telling us silently that we can and quite possibly will persist even in a world that can seem all too ready to be free of us. You know, we may not be much as a species. Not when you look at our history, our wars, our habit of rewarding the rich and depriving the poor. But we're possessed of a tenacity, a profound and inexhaustible drive simply to go on, that verges on genius. Thank you.
Thank you. And I would like to ask you some question about Italy and about,
of course,
your relation with our country. This is beautiful song of love for Matera. Is an incredible place. I think that it's different from any other town.
Very different. Yes.
But I would like to know if there are other Italian cities or regions or places that you particularly like, when with which you feel a tie or an affinity.
You know, I could trot out the places that certainly all Americans and most people seem to love, you know, Firenze and Roma. Who needs to hear that? Beatrice, I hope I won't embarrass you, but I go most summers to stay for a few days, maybe a week, at the home of my friend Beatrice in Toscana, up in the hills. The nearest attraction, really, the town of Donini is, as I understand it, Donini is Italian for nothing here. Dough is nothing in Nini. So, but my apologies to anyone who has a relationship to Donini. But the nearby town is of no great interest. It is very close to the, I believe, Europe's biggest designer shopping mall. And that's always diverting. Big buses pull up and people pile out to fight over Gucci bags. But that's not why I want to talk about Beatrice's house. Beatrice's house is a 600-year-old farmhouse that Beatrice and her late husband, Gregor von Rezzori, a remarkable and enduring writer, rebuilt out of its own ruins. And it is, I think, probably literally the most mysterious and consoling place I know. There's the main house with a once billiard room. Now the billiard table is entirely covered with books. You can't even see that there's a pool table in there anymore because we prefer reading to playing games. There are incredible works of art that I every year devalue by leaning my head against. I usually stay, and you know, as anyone who comes from any country is accustomed to its vegetation, its animals. I had never seen purple bumblebees the size of my thumb until I went to Santa Maddalena. And I often stay in the two top rooms of the signal tower, where many people have stayed, but it was the favorite room. There's a bedroom and then a study on top of Bruce Chatwin, the remarkable writer who is no longer with us, and Bruce, who I never met, was obsessive. I wouldn't know anything about that, but yeah, everything had to be square. There's a square table that's exactly in the middle of the square room. It's all very much as Bruce had it, and I think it's almost literally as it was when Bruce Chatwin last stayed there. Most nights, the most beautiful little pitch black bat flies in through the window and just sort of flutters around and does what we admire most in bats, which is go out again. And, you know, I don't mean this literally. I'm not quite that romantic, but it's impossible not to imagine that the bat is, it's not Bruce's ghost, but it's some sense of a returning presence. that's there to see that the room is all right, that the square table is still in the middle where it belongs, that the terracotta sculptures are on the shelves where the terracotta sculptures belong, that the pink walls are still that shade of pink that's been painted into the plaster, and then the little black bat, having made her nightly rounds, flies out again. Until next time.
Okay. Another question. I think the relation to a country and to a people is built also through a relation to its language. No? Most of your works, all of your works, have been translated into Italian. You are very popular in writer in Italy. But it happens to you during the translation to collaborate with the translator and speak about the difference between the language in translation, a book, and more generally, which is your relation with the Italian language, if any relation?
You know, it depends on the translator. Some translators want to work more closely with the writer than others, and I respect what the translator wants. But one of the things you learn very quickly working with any translator, well, you learn a few things. You learn that translation is impossible. That not only do certain words not translate, but certain concepts don't translate. I'll keep this short. I was talking to my Finnish translator a while ago. There's a phrase in my last novel, The Snow Queen, which a character talks about driving out into the mad American night, which is from Jack Kerouac from On the Road. But most American readers, even if they don't know who Kerouac is, get the idea. Driving out into the mad American night, you know, abandoning your life, buy a Lincoln Continental with all your savings and just go out there to start a new life. And I said to this guy, I bet you can't drive out into the mad Finnish night, can you? And I bet you wouldn't want to. So, you know, and this is what's really interesting, is not just the phraseology, it's coming up against different cultural assumptions. Yeah. It's realizing that as an American, I have this romance of a vast continent where I could just start over, that to a Finnish reader, just what? It's just insane. But I've also learned, and this is maybe the most significant thing I've learned from talking to translators. I've talked about this before, but it's been a while. You realize that the original that you write in your own language is already a translation. Because floating in the cartoon balloon over your head was a greater book than you're able to write. Even if the book turned out reasonably well, you had expected something grander and darker and funnier and smarter and deeper. So the original feels like a not so great translation. And then if somebody just takes it further along and translates it that into yet another form, that's just another step on the process, on the endless cycle of questionable translations.
And you think also there is a difference of sound, because now you know Italian language is different, more musical, I think, that and you feel it. Have you ever read your book in translation in Italian? Have you ever tried to?
I have, just to get a sense of the rhythm of the language. I teach writing, and one of the things I tell my students is you should write in a way that if a passage of what you write were read to someone who doesn't speak the language, it should still sound like something. You know, it should have a rhythm. It should be like boom, boom, or it should have flow and spark and music. And yeah. I do read the Italian and other translations just to sort of get a sense of almost how it sounds in another language. And I'm very much aware of the fact. I encourage my translators to take liberties. Until recently, my translator in Italian has been a friend who's also a very good writer and has become a filmmaker, Ivan Cantoneo.
Yeah.
And I always feel that my books in English are books by Michael Cunningham, and my books in Italian are books by Michael Cunningham and Ivan Cantoneo. Yeah.
That's true. Okay. You spoke before of for me a beautiful movie shot in Matera was Gospel According to St. Matthew, Vangelo Secondo Matteo by Pier Paolo Pasolini. And I read somewhere that your family from your mother's side is Catholic, and that your mother was very religious. And I wonder, visiting a Catholic country like Italy is, or perhaps was, or is, I don't know, did you find or feel something related to your family environment? Did you find the atmosphere?
Yeah. You know, I'm not Catholic. I'm not religious.
Yeah.
But we had a slightly funny arrangement in my family. My mother was Catholic. My father was not. Neither one of them wanted to convert. And so my mother continued to practice her faith, but very quietly. Mm-hmm. My sister and I could decide. We went to a few masses when we were kids and thought, well, you know, maybe not. But our mother kept going, and you know, we had the most ordinary, imaginable suburban house with shag carpeting and you know sectional sofas and all that stuff. There were no crucifixes, there were no statues of bleeding saints, and yet there was the scent of incense somehow. You know,
Yeah. You
could detect it. It was my mother's faith, and it filled the house, it filled our lives, and it was the strangest experience because although I grew up with no literal belief in any of that, I was sort of infected by belief, and I can't discount it. I can't scoff at it, even though I don't share in any of it. It's like, you know, I guess if I walk into a church, an especially beautiful Romanesque church up in the hills of Tuscany that we always go to, I do feel a little like, oh, right, home was like this. That thing. And, oh, you know, religion is so difficult because it has so much harm in the world. And yet the impulse to worship as opposed to the impulse to shop should be at least somewhat honored.
Okay, thank you. Now I ask to the audience if you have some question you want, please.
I think it is the most brilliant story that was written in the 20th century by an American writer. And what you did with that, and I'm going to try and make a scaffolding connection, but really I want to just honor you with it, is the complexity and the clarity that you meshed in there is as good as anyone has ever done. Truly, I believe that. And I think what you did tonight was to once again layer in all of the complexities of Matera. And I have the Malapa de Matera. I dream about Matera.
Yeah. Oh.
And I think you did that perfectly again. But truly, I just honor your work.
Thank you. That's wonderful to hear. I should quickly. Yes, thank you. No more questions. Yeah, it's a story called White Angel, right? The story, yeah, about the accident. Yeah, yeah. I think however imperfectly any of we who write manage it, I just think it is part of the writer's job. It's what can make us irritating on occasion. It is our job to say, oh, it's not that simple. It's never that. So whatever you think is no. There's more going on than that. I mean, I think that's part of what we're here for.
You were talking about almost this bird's eye view of Matera and all the kind of, especially with the recent history of tourism, the new hotels opening up, all these things. And there's kind of what's interesting about Italy, especially with the tourism angle, and you've probably seen it in, you know, Umbria and Tuscany all over the place, is how towns are affected both positively and negatively by the influence of this. I'm trying to find another word from and fearful, but how much do you think Matera could be negatively both positively affected by those things in the same way that you see that around Tuscany or Umbria, just the postcardification, right? The Epcotization of these contacts.
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you mean. Can everybody hear that? Certain cities and towns can almost become versions of themselves, the kind of Epcot center. It's the real thing, but it's also an imitation of the, it's imitating itself. I may be wrong about this, but I just don't see that happening to Matera. It's so solid. It's so, as I was saying, there. It's unmalleable. You could fix up the caves and make them more habitable, but I think Matera is made of a kind of stone that will resist. I'm not putting this the way I'd like to. I think Matera has been itself for so long, it's too late for it to be anything but itself. Please.
I think that it's very interesting, the collapse between Europe and Italy.
Yeah. Kind of no, it's been visited. Let's just say I'm not worried about Matera. I'm worried about almost everything else.
Also about Italy. Okay. Please.
The oldest, perhaps the oldest city in Europe or the world. Now, do you mean Matera of the caves or the built Matera? Because I thought Damascus was the oldest.
Let's see if we have some tips. It's small. And it's not difficult to see the whole thing in a few days. I think you'll want to walk around at night, because that's when I have no reason to imagine that it's dangerous, but that's when it feels more like itself. That's when it feels sort of haunted, but in the best possible sense. And that's when you look across. There's a valley that separates the modern, the town that's only 2,000 years old from the really, really old part with the caves, and you can sort of see the ghostly outlines of the caves. Just walk around, go into the churches, look at the frescoes. It's not a bad idea to get a guide, but make sure the guide takes you to the abandoned caves, not just to the sort of fixed up parts. Because as recently as the 60s, Matera was a slum. It was all drugs and prostitutes and people living in caves with no plumbing and no electricity. And I would say don't let anyone try to, some of those places are still there. Don't let anyone try to steer you away from seeing that part of Matera.
Okay, I would like to thank you, Michael Cunningham, to be here and to, and you for coming. It's an awful night outside, but it was a beautiful night inside. Thank you again.